voi se non capite qualcosa, se volete dire qualcosa, me lo potete dire o in italiano o in inglese o in norvegese, se qualcuno lo vuole dire in norvegese. Però io voglio fare questa lezione in inglese perché l'ho fatta tante volte in inglese e ho paura che se la faccio in italiano mi arrotolo. Quindi mi dispiace, vi chiedo perdono e spero che sia. Che venga bene in inglese. Allora, my name is Letizia Jaccheri. I work at NTNU, the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. We receive each year many students from Europe, from the world. We have received a couple of students from the University of Pisa, and one of my goals today is to invite you to consider, first of all, to invite you to go abroad because it's a fantastic experience to travel somewhere else and learn from other realities, but above all, in my case, to invite you to consider the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. So the title, From Software Through Art to Social Entrepreneurship, that we discover now that in Italian means imprenditorialità sociale. And you find this presentation on my blog, letiziajaccheri.org, so you don't need to note down or whatever. And again, if you have questions, if you have critics, stop me and tell. My goal is not to go through the whole presentation, my goal is to interact with you. I have also prepared some interaction through a software called Mentimeter, but we do it at the end of the lecture only if there has not been enough interaction during the lecture. When I have given these presentations several times in different universities in the world, even in Pakistan, and each time I start by telling I come from Pisa. I'm very proud to have been a student of this university. I'm very proud that in Pisa, as you all know, the first Italian computer was built in the 60s. Imagine that in Norway, where I work, the first computer was bought in the 60s. So I'm very proud to have studied in a place that built its own computer in the 60s. But here I don't have to explain so much to you about the University of Pisa because you know better than me now. I want to explain about my university where I work now. This picture is taken in a winter night when the aurora is going on. We don't have aurora so often because we are not that north, only 62 degrees north. If you go farther north, you have more chance to see the aurora, but you have some chances to see the aurora in Trondheim. Anyway, our university has circa 40,000 students. That is almost the same amount of students you have here in three cities: Trondheim, that is the main place of the university, and then Ålesund and Gjøvik, that are cities quite far away. And these numbers are not so interesting, maybe, to students, but are more interesting to professors. I didn't know who should come here. Maybe for you it's not so interesting how much money the university get. The NOK, the Norwegian krone, is our money, and it's worth one tenth of the euro. So when I say that the university has a budget of 10 billion, 1 billion is un miliardo, it means one it becomes 1 billion euro per year. So it's quite a big organization that is going on. My department, the Department of Computer Science at the university, has several study programs, and we take in 500 students per year for a total of 3,000 students at the department. We have been maybe too ambitious. We have become very big with 350 employees, including the PhD students. Who have heard about Kahoot? Nobody? Okay. We are very, very proud of Kahoot, and it's a pity that you have not heard. Next time I will make a Kahoot. It's a quiz system that has been used all over the world, And one colleague of mine, this Alfing, is the inventor of the game. And we played first time in 2013 in the meeting room with the group. And then suddenly in 2016, it was already a big success, sold out to outside the university. And last week it was quoted on the stock exchange for something like more than 5 billion Norwegian kron. This kind of information maybe are not so, you students are not so used to learn this information about money, but my students in Norway, they are very interested. And here I want to hear your opinion later. Is it interesting for you to know that an idea that a professor and some students has developed and we saw for first time in 2013, now it's a global success that has been used in all countries. Please Google Kahoot. It has been used in all countries except for North Korea. Not yet in North Korea, but otherwise all other countries have used Kahoot and has 1 billion of games that have been played. It's a quiz game system to activate students in the classroom. Another thing that our department is very famous about is the search engine FAST that was made in the 90s before Google was developed. But then Google became so famous, FAST became a bit famous. It was bought by Microsoft in 2008, and it was bought more than 10 years ago for a sum that is around the one that is now the value of Kahoot. So very big projects that give a lot of attention to us at the department. It's very popular for students in Scandinavia to study at our Department of Computer Science that is called EDI. So what I do all the day long since I left Pisa 30 years ago, I have been working with that professor who is a father of software engineering in not only Norway but in Europe and maybe in internationally. When I go to the International Software Engineering Conference, people don't ask me how are you, they ask me how is your professor. He is called Reidar Kondrati. And what I love most is to work in a course that is called either Software and Art or Software and Entrepreneurship. And this is a picture taken in my course with my students. Mostly they are international students. For 4 years, I was department head, so I couldn't teach because when you have 300 people and 3,000 students, it was really crazy. And then we were doing these things like starting new labs, and I was dealing, getting visits from the politicians in Norway. These are two ministers in Norway at the time, Minister of Culture and Industry and Trade. They look quite young and maybe a bit different from the minister we are used to see. But then after 4 years, I decided that I wanted to go back to my students. And last year, I was very happy to have 8 master students that were working in different areas. And I show to you these students because they best represent what I am doing now. I work with software for adolescents with mental disabilities. You see, these 3 master students have been doing apps for that. Josten here, he did a study in Malawi to how to develop app to prevent child marriage for young women in countries where child marriage is an issue. She was doing a thesis about a game for empathy. And he was doing something for girls and computer science, some games that enhance the interest in computer science for girls. And these two were working on theme more related to SE, means social innovation, that is a big umbrella for social entrepreneurship. So if you want to come to Norway next year maybe and work with me, you can imagine projects like this that I will be happy to discuss with you if you want, either today or by email later. So I come, as I told you, from Pisa. This is a slide that I added to my presentation today. I don't tell about these things when I am somewhere else. As I will tell you, for me, it's very important to do good research and to have good role models. And when I look back, when I was a student, I have had three main role models. One is Ambriola, who was my supervisor in software engineering. One is Linda Pagli, who, and now I don't have much paper in my office. I throw all the paper away. But that book by Linda and Lucio is still there. I think I will never throw it away. And another mentor that you don't see very well, I think the only one who recognizes her must be Maria and Susanna, is Paolo Inverardi, who is really a hot shot in software engineering in the world. When I travel to the software engineering conference, first they ask me about my professor, then I ask where is Paola, and I really enjoy to meet her each year. She is now rector at in L'Aquila, and she is great. And I think I have been so grateful to have these women as role models when I was a student, because for me, it was not strange to become professor, because I have seen Linda, I have seen Maria, I have seen Paola, I have seen Ambriola, but male professor, we see a lot of them. But for me, it was normal. It was, I never doubted that I wanted to become like Linda. And when Linda visited us in Trondheim, and some of my colleagues told me, you look really like her. Yes, my dream. I was so proud that finally somebody has met my role model and they think that I am really like her. But now, a bit more about me. 15 years ago, I understood that I have been like computer science student for 20 years. So I thought, 20 years. And then I wrote this book that in Italian is called Cuore Computer, that you cannot buy anymore in the bookshop. But if you go on my homepage, you can download it. And it's a simple book. You read it in a couple of hours about my story as a child in Pisa and then computer science student and Norway and so on. And when I look back, I think that you asked me, but what have you done all this year? I think I have tried to understand the relationship between software, between computers and art. And I'm really jealous of you who are students of Informatica Humanistica, because it didn't exist in my time. And if it had existed, for sure I would choose Informatica Humanistica, because it's really what I would like to understand. I wanted to understand, and I still want to understand, this relationship between life and art. And then, if I could switch, I don't want to switch now. I ask you, I will ask you questions later, but now I take a small break and ask you if you have any questions or any reflection about what I have been saying until now. No? Okay, then we can go ahead and we take these questions interactively later. So, after this very long introduction, I want to go in the main presentation that will have 4 points: research, software, art, and social innovation. And try to follow me. So try, in the end, I want you to tell me, okay, you told a coherent story, or maybe if you think, okay, you told me many things that I don't see the connection, I really want to know the critics. I'm not here to show how clever I am, I'm here to learn together with you. So please, if something is strange, if you something you want to criticize, tell, you will make me a present. So, research. I think, and as I told to you, what is important is to do good research and to have good role models, and the role models can be even either the big professor you had for 30 years ago, but it can also be the person you interact in the group work that day. It's very, very important to interact with good people and to make the people we interact with good. And in 2006, at our university, we get a Nobel Prize, not me, but this couple, Edward Moser and Maybrit Moser, get a Nobel Prize in medicine. It was a big joy for a university farther north in Scandinavia to get this prize. And I like very much the way they describe one of their papers. They describe in such simple way, this truly special paper highlights the power of studying artificial intelligence for understanding our own brain. Very simple. What do? They want to understand the brain. That helped me to reshape my own story. What do I want to do? I want to understand the relationship between art and software. And then we go inside and we do many small projects, but the main goal must be clear and must be simple. And my Brit here, the woman in the Nobel Prize couple, she's of course a role model for all of us, and she's very visible, and she is again the kind of professor that in my head and in my heart is how I would like professors to appear, not some strange creatures with white beards staying in a lab, but a nice, open woman who goes around and share her knowledge with us. And she is so kind, so open, that when you talk to her, you feel you are like a Nobel Prize yourself. So, if I could show to you this video, but I don't need, because you can see from the slide, you can just click on the YouTube later and look. Shall we try? Because this is an example, okay. We didn't try that. Okay.
Cerebral palsy affects approximately 4% of the 15 million premature children born yearly. The earlier we can diagnose this disorder, the sooner we can reduce the risk of further damage. Normally, teams of doctors and physical therapists diagnose cerebral palsy through painstakingly observing the child's movements and interactions. A time-consuming process requiring experts and hospital facilities. At NTNU's AI lab, we are developing a new way of identifying cerebral palsy quickly and accurately, using deep learning for medical image analysis. In the first examination, the child's movements are filmed. Then, a computer analyzes the images and identifies children with potential symptoms of cerebral palsy using advanced artificial intelligence before a specialist verifies the findings. Using this approach, NTNU's interdisciplinary collaboration speeds up the diagnosis process and allows children in need to receive early treatment. Our researchers have also developed a mobile app that allows parents to carry out an initial assessment of their child in the stress-free surroundings of their own home. However, as with all digital systems, even machine learning and artificial intelligence has its limits, physical limits, due to the fact that this technology is based on an over 50-year-old method fast approaching its maximum tolerance. Inspired by the human brain, researchers at AI Lab are developing new technology that can provide a starting point for the future. By engineering networks of living neurons, we get insight into the learning processes of the brain. From this, we can mimic brain function in nanomagnets to create computer technology for the future. While technologists want to create new computers and neuroscientists are striving to learn how to restore neural connectivity and function, our team works to implement aspects from both disciplines, using robotics to explore the communication between living neurons, electrical circuits, and the physical world. The insight we gain from this comprehension can one day create the next generation of computers and help paraplegics walk again. If in-depth knowledge of artificial intelligence goes hand in hand with an understanding of how it may be applied, we can develop the technology of tomorrow. With Norwegian OpenAI Lab, industry and research come together to create artificial intelligence for a better future.
Okay, let's see if I manage to go back to the other presentation.
So you want your website to be stunning and professional.
No. So let's see, because usually I don't use Mac. So I am a bit, Maria, I think I will need your help. I'm sorry. Si possa tornare indietro qui. Ancora indietro? No. Questo si chiude. Non sa fare. Vabbè, si riapre, dai. Grazie. Oh, I'm sorry. It's okay. So we had 4 points. Research, and this video is an example of a collaborative research effort that has led to a lab that is called Norwegian Open AI Lab that address the several issues that you can do with using ICT for social purposes. And here you have seen that they use artificial intelligence technique to help to diagnose children with cerebral paresis. Here I have not worked in this project as a researcher, but when I was a department head, I helped to set up the project to get the permission to take walls down and to organize the things around the lab. But if you are interested in coming and working with us, I will connect you properly with the people who are doing research in the lab. So going to software, I told you that I originally wrote, I was a student of Vincenzo Andriola. I wrote a master thesis in software engineering about software development environment. And my most cited work is about a very simple idea that is described in this paper and a couple of related ones. If you want, you can go and download the paper from Google Scholar and see what we have done. The idea is very, very simple. It says that when we that first we want to run experiments in software engineering in the same way like other scientists do experiments. So we want to collect data in a structured way. We want to have hypotheses. We want to analyze this data. And as in they have done in psychology and medicine for many years, we wish to use students as subjects of our experiment, but we don't want only to use students. We want to have a balance between the pedagogical goal of what the students are learning and the research goal of our experiments. This work, at the beginning, it was almost not mobbed, but people gave me the feedback that it was such a simple idea. But now it's very cited. And almost all the research in the world, when they want to set up software engineering experiments with students, they cite our work. That gives some guidelines, give also some ethical guidelines about what to do when setting up this investigation. And it's something that I am proud of, and we have been we do still experiments around open source systems, because open source systems are not only a source of free software, but they are also a source of free data. For us who are researchers in software engineering, it's amazing how much data we can get from those projects to enhance the state of the knowledge in software engineering. Last year we did I still work in software engineering as a researcher, even if I do many other things. And last year we wrote this paper about software engineering for startup companies. And now there is a PhD student who is bringing this research ahead. And I think that this kind of research is very interesting, and it's it makes software engineering a much more funny topic of study, if you can study how can I help myself as an entrepreneur to develop software that can have some business impact, not only to see software engineering like the process that is followed in a very big companies that have very big products, and but how to help with software engineering knowledge the small companies that that produce app, that produce new software for the IoT. This is something we are studying now, and my students find it very exciting. And I think this is like a renaissance for software engineering to look into this kind of smaller, more agile realities. So here, if we could use the Menti, I would have three questions about software. And I wish to ask you, please tell me something. Which software do you think it's important now in Italy? Example, in Norway, nobody uses WhatsApp. You say WhatsApp, what is WhatsApp? In Norway, we have other software like this Kahoot, everybody, even the old women in the daycare, they play Kahoot in Norway, but you say that you don't know what Kahoot is. So if just talk two and two with your neighbor and say, okay, if I have to say what is an important software now in Italy, what would I answer? So just talk a bit between each other and Qualcuno vuole dire cosa avete detto? Cosa pensate? Susanna, te cosa hai detto?
Sicuro, anzi, è diventato anche troppo invasivo, ormai mettono nei gruppi senza che però io uso anche molto sul telefono, Google Search, Facebook. Software di Google che mette insieme tutte le notizie locali, nazionali, internazionali e te le propone, si chiama Google News.
Voi? Qualcosa di nuovo che voi giovani avete, di cui avete cominciato a sentir parlare, che secondo voi io non so? Cos'è un astro nascente del software? Telegram è russo, no?
Telegram?
Credo sia russo.
Ma perché in Italia si usa molto l'app per il telefono, non sono i software. Le persone non conoscono molto i software, per esempio della gestione, che hanno un particolare scopo, ma social media è diverso, anche tra i giovani sono molto popolari. C'è una specie di campo, almeno tra ragazzi molto giovani al liceo, l'Italia è una specie di campo di esplorazione, perché prendono moltissimo tutti i social. sono nuovi. No, Instagram è molto vecchio, ma nuovi più che altro software cinesi qui tra i
WeChat. Tra,
no, no, neanche WeChat, TikTok, scambi di video.
Interessante.
Cambiano ogni 5-6 mesi.
Bello, ora dopo quando vi faccio le domande con questo menti me li scrivi questi software, interessante, grazie. Altre considerazioni? Ok, then I go ahead, going to art, and here most of you know much more than me, because I know that in informatica umanistica you have a different background, so maybe who has a bachelor in computer science? Chi è che ha fatto la triennale di informatica? Nessuno. E che triennale avete fatto voi, quindi? Informatica umanistica? A tutti informatica? No. Those who, quelli che non hanno fatto informatica umanistica, chi sono? Ditemi cosa avete studiato.
Lettere.
Lettere, che bello. Filosofia?
Political science.
Political science? Interessantissimo, bello. Meraviglia. Quindi, then, now, art. That art and technology have been in contact for many, many years. When I talk to computer scientists, I have really to make good arguments to say that this is something that it's worth to use time. I think that with you, we say in Italian, I open an open door. I think that most of you are aware that art and technology have been together, that people has exploited technology in art and art in technology, and there is a lot of common work. The one of the best example is the movie industry, and there are these, for those who have studied philosophy, I'm almost ashamed to stand here and talk to you about futurist, about Duchamp, about modernism. So there is a lot of theories behind the work in art and technology. The first computer art exhibition, as far as I know, was held in 1965, and this is amazing because it's the year when I was born. And I think how much time I have used to convince my old colleagues when I was young that it was legitimate to work with art and technology. And it's something that is more than 50 years old, this art and computer. Who did not know about this exhibition? If I had that, you did not know, or?
No, I just went, could you speak a little bit louder? Just speak up.
Okay, maybe I should have used the microphone then. Okay, thank you very much for I try. So, does anybody know about this first art and technology exhibition that was held, computer art exhibition that was held in New York in 65? No. Okay, but anyway, if I tell you that, is it something strange for you, or is it something that you would have imagined that already 50 years ago people was dealing with computer art? Okay. They didn't tell us when we were students here. No. But but it is.
Bisogna dirlo anche piano adesso, perché non è detto che, diciamo, facciamoci sentire troppo.
Anyway, when I started to work with art and technology around 2000 and something, what we did together with my colleagues, we said, okay, we will look into the intersection between computer and art, But since the only methods we know, or research methods we know, come from software engineering, we cannot reinvent everything. We use the research method that we come from before, that we can use from before, and we study this new field. And this functioned quite well. We were able to publish. This paper is a literature review, a systematic literature review, and it's quite strange because artists are not so used to work in this systematic way, but we cooperated. We two are computer scientists. We cooperated with one of the few art professors in Norway, and we went through the formal process of software engineering to study the literature in interactive art installation. And this paper is published in the first number of the first volume of this journal of arts and technology. If you are interested in arts and technology, you can download that paper. It's very interesting because at the time they were starting to produce digital art installation in the public space. Not only these small things that function in a museum, but things that are really outside. It was the time where they started with displays in shopping malls, displays in the museums, all these things that you study at Informatica Humanistica. So maybe this paper can be interesting for some of you who want to see how the display art, how the robot art, and how this kind of projects have evolved until 2018. I would love to redo this work now, after more than 10 years. I must say that I supervised, together with Vincenzo, one student of Informatica Humanistica, Leonora, and she did something as a continuation of this work. So if somebody of you is interested to see, okay, what has happened in the last 10 years since they made this this work, I would be very, very happy to discuss with Maria or with Vincenzo, with somebody who want to bring this work ahead. At the same time, in Norway, it's not so easy for us professors to get funding for new PhD students. We have really to earn every single krone to be able to pay our PhD. And so in the art sector, it's not so easy. I cannot go to a company and say, "Ah, please pay for a student who will study art installation." But at that time, I managed to get one PhD in art and technology, and he wrote a quite beautiful thesis, mainly about an installation that is in a backyard of a school in Trondheim. Those of you who will visit me, we can go and see this installation. It's a big spider that children can go inside and play with the installation by sending some sound files that are played back to the school by the installation itself. And the research question is a software engineering like research question: how to develop software dependent artworks. And the main lessons learned, it's not very easy to understand afterwards, but I didn't think so much about it before. It is that when the municipality allocates resources to the building of such installation, it costed a couple of million Norwegian krones, or 200,000 euro at the time. It's a lot of money, but not so much when it's art in the public space. But the problem is that software engineering tells us, even if we are in the first course of software engineering, we learn that 80% of the effort will go to maintenance, 20 to development, 80 to maintenance. And concerning art, there is no budget for maintenance. So who is going to pay and who is going to do the update of the software of the hardware of the telecommunication sensors of this installation. This was something that was not planned from before, and something that by our research we try to give advice to those who want to do these projects, that when they plan these projects they have to follow some simple software engineering guidelines. So there are a lot of interesting projects going ahead now in the art and technology field. The reference in Europe is the Ars Electronica arena, and there are one of the last projects that I studied that I would love to have resources to study in a good way is this one, where they build an installation that connects wine energy to blockchain development, and show how much energy the blockchain technology use by, you can see from the wild system how much energy you need to mine a Bitcoin and to, so by using art you make visible some technical issues that otherwise will be very much hide inside the machine, inside the head of the people who is dealing with blockchain. But this is something that I would like to study, but we have not studied yet. So, about art, I will have some questions for you later. And now we will jump to the fourth part of the presentation, that is social innovation. So, we started from research, software, art, and now social innovation, and I will tell you why I work now with social innovation. In 2016, if you show me social entrepreneurship, social innovation, I would be able to translate into my head, but I had not reflected about that. But what happened in, why do I work now with social innovation? In around 2015, since I was working with art and technology, one particular woman, this Liv Arnesen, whom you don't know, because I don't think you know Liv Arnesen, but in Norway everybody knows her because she is the first woman who went by ski unsupported to South Pole alone. So she's quite brave. And I met her at a conference, and I presented all the art and technology projects, and she liked me, and of course I like her, and she says, but come to help me with my next expedition to make some installation that will give attention to the water challenge. Yeah, why not? Students, next time we will propose this to my students. And so the idea was, how can we design and evaluate software that becomes a medium to engage and inform the user? So one group was particularly creative. What did they do? They went to the second-hand shop, and for 10 euro they bought a bike, una ciclette, and they connected some sensors, even simpler than Arduino sensors, to the pedals of the ciclette, and so they connected from the bike to the Scratch, you know the software Scratch, and they made a game that was about water and was driven by the bike. So that game is very simple. It shows a country. If the country is like Sweden, in order to produce some water, you can just bike very slowly and the water comes. But if you are in Ghana or in somewhere in Sahara, near to Sahara region, in order to produce water, you have really to bike with a lot of energy. And that game was so beautiful that the students get a lot of attention in the media, and they won prizes and so on. Not because of, I did not do much. I was only there and I connected the students to the Explorer. And what happened then? That another student saw that project, and he came to me and said, I want to do something commercial. I want to become an entrepreneur, and I want to do a real game that it is will be possible to sell. I want to make money out of it. Okay, I say, let's try. So they worked for a whole year for their master, and they make this bike. My colleague, the one who has done the Kahoot, also liked the project and entered the team and helped. So after, this paper is from 2016, published at CAI, after 1 year, the Prime Minister of Norway is biking on one of these bikes, and this game is installed in many, many training centers in Norway. Personally, I came out of the project. I am very good friends, both of the student and of the professor, but I don't want to use my nights to search for investor and for money. So I want to work with other projects. I want to come here and work with Susanna and Stefano and meet you. So I people ask, but why are you not part of that company? No, because it was funny for me to be the supervisor, to write paper. It's funny if they invite me to a party when they get money from the investors. I go and drink champagne with them, but I don't want to use now my nights and day to work there. But it's so funny when I go to the gym and I see that bike now is in use. And above all, it's very nice to see that many young people who have, for example, diabetes and were otherwise not exercising, that by help of this bike that is connected to this, for me, terrible computer shooting computer games, they go down 20 kilos in weight, they lose a lot of weight, and they enjoy that game so much. And yes, so another project that I instead stay awake on at night to think about is the Kudeløypa. It's a coding workshop for children that we started around 15, and we proposed to the children some art robots, and we proposed to the children that they make games by help of Scratch. And each week at our department, a classroom visits us and they go through this framework. And here again, we supervised a PhD student. She has been extremely productive. She has written a lot of papers. So those of you who are interested in coding activities for children can download these papers. And here we have like refined our research method, because the PhD student and other colleagues in the group, they have proposed that we should use the gaze, the glasses. So we give to the children glasses so that we can track where they are looking while they are programming. So we can see if they look more at the robots, or if they look more at the instruction, or if they look more at which part of code they look, so we can understand, and not least if children are cooperating with each other, or if they sometimes are so challenged that only one is working and the rest of the group is doing something else. So this is the research that is going ahead now. Now a new PhD student started, and she will try to insert security in the framework. And for security, I observe that the security arena is even more male-dominated. Correct me if I'm wrong. Security is even more male-dominated than programming. When I see the pictures of the security challenges, there are only boys. And so I am way awake at night now to think, how can we attract girls? How can we attract other people to security? But we don't want to leave the security knowledge to the nerds. There are a lot of human aspects in security, and I think that many people should contribute, and we should be able to know about security and tell what we should do. And yes, So you saw at the beginning that one of my master students last year was working with this app called Tappetina Empathy. Susanna has read her work. This is a game that should not teach, but that should like stimulate people, young people, to become more empathic. That should like exercise the empathic abilities of the young people. Here we are in a very start phase. We have published a couple of papers, but we are still at the very beginning. And together with Susanna and Stefano, we plan to build new projects that will take this idea and their ideas ahead together. So I think that here there can be possibility for master students to work and to bring this. It's a storytelling game that has the goal of challenging and improving the empathy ability of those who play. And also I have this obsession of social good, but again, we are at the very beginning, and I have this assumption that when you sit and shoot and try to kill and going around, the story that you are dealing with is not so socially good, and other stories have a higher level of social goodness, but this is not something that we can say in a scientific way yet. I think we will have to work, and I think that people like you would really contribute and help us to understand what does it mean that a story has high social value and that another story has low social value. I don't know. This is something for the future. And yes, here it's a list of projects that we work with. I took the freedom to say that I am part of my dentist. I hope you are not angry at me. That is the project of Professor Pelagatti and Professor Chiesa here. I have a small role in a project run at the University of Tromsø, that is very far away, 1,000 kilometers north from Trondheim. If you are really adventurous, you can not only come to Trondheim, but ask me about going up to Tromsø. And there they are expert, they are excellent in health informatics. Why? Because the Arctic region is so big and there are so few persons that they have started to use technology and video technology to help people in remote areas since many, many years ago. So if you are interested in health informatics, you should really consider about going to Tromsø, because you will find a university hospital and facilities that are really amazing. At least for me, they are amazing. So my own project, because I participate in many projects, but fortunately I'm not the leader of all, otherwise I would not go to bed. But the project that I lead is this EDU, that is called From PhD to Professor, is a project to encourage women, and not only women, but diversity, people who otherwise would not enter academia, to start as PhD student and to stay in academia. This is one of the activities that now is more dear to me. That's why I think so much about role models. That's why I think so much about research. So to challenge this notion of research, and also going around and asking the student, have you thought about being a PhD student? Many of my students say, I never thought. Why? Because nobody asked me. So this is a suggestion to you professors. I don't know if you ask your students, do you want to become a PhD student, or if you don't ask. And if you are interested in becoming a PhD student, so you should ask the professors, because it's not only the very, very intelligent people with the beard and with look, look at Maria. She always looks like a student, like and she has been a professor for so many years. So you can all make it to enter the PhD studies, to become a researcher, and it's really a lot of fun. At least I love to be a researcher, and I think it's very, very interesting to meet so many people and to do these things that sometimes are impossible and some other times become possible, and suddenly you have the prime minister that is biking on the bike that your student has done. So I think it's very, very nice. And yeah, the last project that I want to mention, we have a cooperation project with China and US, and this is also very interesting and related to what you say about the Chinese app, because last year we went to China with one class of 66 students, and it was amazing what we experienced there. That it's like somehow to go ahead somehow to go behind, and sometimes to go so much ahead in the future. And it's such a different world they have with their own app. They are not using Google, they are not using WhatsApp, they are using totally different ecosystem of software. And yes, I think I am, this is my last slide. I don't know if you, a student, if there are any PhD students here, but for you professors, we will have a conference in April in Norway, and we also have a fellowship for the students. The conference is about empirical software engineering. So if some of you is interested in software engineering and is interested in coming to Trondheim, you can look at this ease2020.org. And this conference, as far as I know, is the first software engineering conference that will have only female keynote speaker. I won the battle. And yeah, this is some of the things I have been doing and I do now. So I don't know what the time is now.
It's 15:12.
So what do you want to do? Shall we run the Menti or shall we have a discussion by human being?
Station?
Yes.
And then, so you can interact.
Yes.